Digital innovation, artificial intelligence, and the evolution of regulation are just some of the factors that mean the transaction banking landscape continues to change rapidly. And in response, banks are innovating at an unprecedented pace.
Joining us now to share her view on how transaction banking is set to evolve is Karen Braithwaite, Global Head of Transaction Banking at Barclays. Welcome to Sibos TV, Karen.
Hello, thank you for having me here.
Okay, and Karen, just how important is the end-to-end digital experience likely to be when you're delivering customer-led experiences in transaction banking?
Yeah, I mean, it's absolutely critical. Transaction banking is actually a pretty commoditized business and has been for a long time. So the way that we in transaction banking differentiate ourselves is through the client experience. And the client experience really is driven by two key things. It's how easy we make it for our clients to do business with us and how intuitive our services are. And the second really is the extent to which that experience is digital. So it's something at Barclays that we're taking very seriously.
So we are here at Sibos 2019. Let's talk the hot topics this year when it comes to transaction banking.
There's so many to choose from, but I think what I'm hearing, obviously the theme around digital and having a full service proposition is absolutely critical. We need to be able to service our clients throughout the entire life cycle, from the point where we onboard them, through the channels that they use with us, and the propositions that we ultimately offer them. And then the other key themes I'm hearing are around open banking, and what that's going to do, the benefits that's going to provide our clients and our customers, and also what the opportunities are to take that further.
Let's stick with the concept of transaction banking, but more specifically, looking ahead to the next 3 years, what do you see as the biggest change in this area? And more specifically, how is Barclays preparing for it?
Yeah, sure. So we're seeing a speed of change that's at the velocity I've never seen in over three decades in the industry. There are a couple of things that I think we're going to see in the coming years that we're already working on. So when I think about global supply chains, the fact that clients are working more and more cross-border, we need to follow our clients and actually lead the way into those markets and be able to provision for them there. So one of the things that actually has been a key strategy for us for a couple of years now has been extending our proposition into Europe and making sure that we're available in the jurisdictions that our clients want to work in. So over the last couple of years, we've extended to now having a presence with a single platform in over 10 countries. And we're going to continue to build out that capability for our clients.
With the introduction of ISO 20022, what impact will this have, do you think, on transaction banks? And how will this benefit all participants?
Yeah, just rolls off the tongue, that one.
It does indeed.
Do you know, ISO 20022, I just feel like I've lived with that forever. It was the concept of it was actually born in the last millennium. I don't know if you know that, but it was 1999 when we first started to talk about the concept of having standardized data formats and actually how that would help. And I'm delighted to see it actually bearing fruit, and we've got payment schemes coming on as early as November 2021. But what it's going to deliver really is two things. The first thing is interoperability, which is a horrible word to try and say. But essentially what it means is that through the ISO standard, we're going to be able to connect together financial markets and payment schemes in a way that we never have been able to do before. And that'll mean that we can send transactions cross-border, linking up instant payment schemes, and money can move around the world in seconds. That also has challenges, and we need to be thinking about what we do from a fraud monitoring perspective, but actually the ability to do that is enormous. And then there's functionality gains. So the ISO 20022 regime basically brings in new data sets in a standardized way. That will help our clients in a couple of ways, really. First of all, we will see increased STP rates, auto reconciliation will improve, we'll see more cost-effective solutions for our clients. The increased information will mean that actually we get less delays when we're moving funds cross-border. And then importantly, from an AML and fraud reporting perspective, we can get much better idea around the origin of the transaction.
And of course, when you're talking about transaction banking, you can't rule out the role of fintechs.
Correct.
And I'd like to get some idea about your views on how banks and fintechs should actually be working together.
That's another great one. There's no single way around this, right? There's no one way of working with fintechs. And in fact, my team and I, we do that in a number of ways, actually. So first of all, we are really pleased with the expertise that we've built up in that sector at Barclays. So they are actually clients of ours. We understand how to work with them, and we actually provide solutions to them. That obviously gives us a good understanding into what the fintechs are actually working on. The other way that we work with fintechs is we actually take investments in them. So we We have innovation hubs, like many of my good competitors do. Today, we have over 150 fintechs actually living with us, if you like, in our hubs around the world. And then on an annual basis, we run something called the Barclays Accelerator, which means over a 13-week period, we take startups in, essentially, and grow them through to actually being real-life companies. And then for me, what I then take from that is that I then work with fintechs to either extend proposition that I have, because they maybe have niche capability that I actually could take value from and perhaps don't want to spend the time and energy investing in. But equally, I can actually work with a fintech provider to expose the services and solutions that I have through their platforms as well. I mean, ultimately, the partnership with fintechs is a win-win for everybody, for the benefit of the clients, for us, and for the fintech providers.
So let's talk about the regulatory landscape at the moment, how that's evolving, and what impact it's having on payment organisations.
Yeah, sure, that's a great question. And you know, this is like an alphabet soup. So we've got GDPR, we've got PSD2, which is really resonating with us all right now. We had MiFID 2, you know, you can name them. Most of them are driven by the need to drive competition and innovation and resiliency into the marketplaces. What we're doing in the organization and the way that our clients will benefit from this is that the client's expectations are being driven higher by what's happening in the regulatory space. So they have an expectation now around ease of use, immediacy, resiliency, and most above all, security when they're actually working with us. So what we're seeing today is we're seeing real credibility around the role of an aggregator. You wouldn't have seen that a couple of years ago. So with the advent of PSD2, the aggregators are actually falling under a regulated regime and partnering with banks to provide the open banking services for our clients. What we're also seeing, and I see this actually through our fintech provisions, essentially is the rise of specialist fintechs. So they're actually providing niche solutions to some of the challenges that we may have around implementing regulation. So what the banks are doing is we're trying very much to embrace what the regulators are trying to deliver at the heart and actually use that to deliver ever better commercial propositions for our clients.
Okay, so a happy union there. But what about the role of data and machine learning? How does that benefit the bank industry? More specifically, how much of a focus is it for Barclays?
It's a huge focus for us. I mean, for me, data is at the centre of digital. It's what actually powers the digital experience at the end of the day. We've invested heavily in making sure that we have appropriate data lineage, that we understand our data principles, and most importantly of all, as a custodian of data, we understand who the owners of that data are. You know, there are many, many use cases that I've seen living and breathing today where we've used AI and modelling on the data to actually provide benefit for our clients. And one that's uppermost in my mind right now as we think about connecting together real-time payment systems through something like ISO 20022 is how do we get a better handle and understanding around which transactions may be fraudulent? You know, so we've actually used AI and artificial intelligence and modelling and we've trained it. We've basically trained models on historic transaction monitoring alerts. Mm. And then having trained those models, we're able then to run that in our payment flows and actually provide an alerting score, essentially, or a probability against that transaction to understand how likely is this to be fraudulent or not. And then we can prioritise our focus on the transactions that may be the most fraudulent in nature.
Okay, so, well done. Yeah. Thank you.
Karen Braithwaite, Global Head of Transaction Banking at Barclays. Thank you very much for speaking to us at Sibos TV.
Thank you.